I gave people all the stuff they really needed. Social security checks, utility bills, TV guide.
I want a TV guidance counselor. TV guidance counselor. Stand up to watch all night, and everything's gonna be alright with my TV guidance counselor.
Hey everybody, welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, as always, your TV guidance counselor. And on hiatus, stand-up comedian, sitting here in Boston, waiting for the end of the world to finally just, it's just a slow-motion end of the world. But anyway, I'm not here to talk about the end of the world. That's for my other podcast about the end times that I haven't started yet, and I won't, but I just thought of right now. Anyway, this week's episode is an excellent episode. It will make you want the world to continue to go on, because it's that good. Although we do discuss quite a lot of end-of-the-world stuff. My guest is someone I've wanted to have on the show for a really long time, someone who I just respect so much and I'm such a huge fan of, Lexi Alexander. She is a martial artist, a writer, a director, just one of the smartest, most moral, amazing people that I know. If you don't follow her on social media, you should. If you don't know her work, check it out. I will put links up to all that stuff in the show description and on tvguidancecounselor.com. But she's the best, and we've been trying to make this happen for a while, but she is very busy, as you would imagine. But she finally had a little bit of time. So we sat down and we had a chat, and I couldn't have been happier with it. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Lexi Alexander.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
My voice cracked there. I got all Greg Brady. My guest this week, live via satellite from sunny Los Angeles, Lexi Alexander. How are you?
I'm good. How are you? Finally, I'm here.
I know. Well, you know, these things, they happen when they're meant to happen.
Exactly.
You can't force it. Yeah, we had talked, geez, it was before the pandemic, so it must have been almost three years ago.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of yours on Twitter. Like, I always, there's a certain few who I just don't see them be ever on the wrong side of things, you know?
And oh, thank you.
It's fascinating because I think it happens to, like, most of us, you know, and that's why, and some people it happens more often.
Yeah.
And others should just stay completely off. Like, I think it's sometimes funny when people like Matt Damon, you know, don't do Twitter. I wouldn't recommend it from him, because apparently he opens his mouth and it's like a tragedy, right?
Oh yeah.
So when, especially like a young white man, when you know, you see like, wow, that, you know, this is like consistently he's on the right side. So I'm always, I always notice it. That's why I'm a big fan. But also, you super pop culture and into 80s things and into vintage stuff. So it's just, I'm a big fan of your Twitter account.
Oh, thank you. We oddly have a lot in common, which people would not necessarily guess.
I actually totally, they wouldn't guess, but I totally picked that up. And it's odd because there's not a lot of American guys I have a lot in common with, but it's so...
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's always, that is one of my favorite things about, especially doing this show, is I discover a lot more kindred spirits than I thought existed, which is kind of the great thing about, you know, social media and the internet, but maybe the one good thing.
I was just talking about that in this whole debate about crypto. I always have to go out there and kind of explain that it actually means a lot in the world of, in other countries where people are not free. And finally, I said today, crypto is a lot like the internet. The internet can be great, but it's also, and probably more so, famous for Gamergate,
yeah.
It just is what it is, you know. When the internet first came out, I was just, oh my God, this is going to bring equality to all, because even the pirating, I always thought it was so fascinating, because when you see pirate sites, and I frequent them often, I'm not ashamed to admit, when you see them, you kind of see, because nobody has to pay, and you kind of figure out who's seeding and who's leeching, and all of a sudden you see this movie that nobody's heard of at top, and you know that, what doesn't play here is what's star name is in it, how much the studio spent on P&A, because, you know, that usually depends on how much they like the showrunner or filmmaker, right? All of that stuff. And so when I first saw that, I thought this would be like the equalizer. And then it turned out quite the opposite, you know, but.
Well, it depends on the users. It ended up being the users, like for the thing with crypto. I think people, you know, we look at like crypto bro dudes and the kind of, who are the same people as. Yeah, the same people as the dot-com assholes in the 90s who were, but it's like you're blaming the medium for the people it attracted. But anything that is a little bit Wild West is going to attract some huge assholes who want to take advantage of it. And so it's that balance of being able to exactly like sort of not democratize, I guess, but make everything available to everyone. And even on those, the file sharing sites, it's like, somebody does pay for it, but it's the people who should have been paying for it. So it's almost supplementing, you know, like a box office movie, let's say, like the studio can afford to make it. The people who paid to see it, they're not starving to death. Even if a movie doesn't, you know, is a bomb, most of the money that they say that they didn't make is fake, where they're like, we didn't pay ourselves back for that loan we gave ourselves that we pay, you know, like the weird studio numbers. So the fact that it gets to people in countries who would never have access to that stuff, even if it's not the most subversive movie, it can be.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. I mean, the CIA did it with Dr. Zhivago. I remember they set that whole thing up, and I always go back to that. And that's kind of on a higher level, but there's a lot of filmmakers and authors, famous ones. Neil Gaiman is one of them, who says piracy, it's better as an author to be famous than not to be famous. You know, the more people read books, the better. And the idea that you're, you know, have 10 books sold and you're like yelling at everybody who's pirating your book, you know, that's, it doesn't really make sense. Like, you want people to know you. That's what radio was all about. And artists wanted to be played on the radio, not for the money they got for it, you know, obviously. They wanted so that they become, you know, the song gets into the charts, it becomes a hit, they become famous. That's what that stuff is for. And so, yeah, I mean, different opinions on that. I will never convince somebody who's on the opposite side, but you're right. It has two, all these things have two sides, you know?
Yeah. And they feed into each other. So you kind of need both for them to continue. But, you know, I when you take one away, it doesn't necessarily make the other one thrive all of a sudden. But I think people like to scapegoat stuff. And that's the world we live in, where executives and money people like to be poor me. This thing didn't work. And it's like, well, no, that's an amazing album. Or that movie's perfect. Just didn't make money. But people should still see it. You know, like it's the money and the creative is always a huge conflict in this world, I've discovered. But we were chatting a little bit before we recorded, and I sent you an issue from 1985, I think September 28th to October 6th. And you grew up in different country from the US, obviously. People could probably hear from your accent. You grew up in
also a double, just like me, a mutt. An accent is neither here nor there.
Because you grew up in both Germany and in Palestine, right?
I spent summers in Jordan, and I learned Arabic and German first, and then I moved here. And when I moved here, I think I was like 19, and at this point, not that I want to admit how old I am, but at this point, I lived here longer than I lived anywhere else, and that's really interesting because, you know. Now I'm missing a lot of stuff that's kind of the pop culture there. And obviously in the first 19 years, I thought I knew a lot about Americans because I was always fascinated with them. But if you remember in the old days, before the internet, you actually didn't. I mean, you know, you got certain TV shows, you know, and, you know, I started training kickboxing with at a place that was basically a military base, a U.S. military base in Mannheim. And I thought what I got from that, from those few shows that I saw and from the music that I listened and from the guys in the base, that's what, you know, America is about. And obviously I got a shock when I came here. You know, first of all, on the base, because it's Americans in a different place. You know, the Americans all stick together, but you don't really find out that there's I mean, I knew it a little bit from history, but I was naive enough to think in the 80s or beginning 90s that, oh, you know, they must have solved all the racism problem because look at how well they all get along here, you know.
Right. But, it's integrated.
You know, I mean, it was strange. And then you go back and you realize that all of these guys that you knew that were all hanging out as friends in that base were living completely different lives in the U.S., you know. And, you know, it was, you know, I remember that and I thought it was so interesting because it was, you know, there was a lot of Hispanic soldiers and black soldiers and white soldiers from the country kind. And honestly, when we had these German-American friendship festivals and stuff, you saw them all get along. Like, and you know, now I look back and I think how naive, of course. They were Americans in Germany. Of course they got along.
Yep.
But, yeah, the shock was huge once I came here and realized, oh, they don't actually hang out here, you know?
Well, I think one of the thing, and all, I think especially all my friends who grew up in Europe or the UK, is it's hard to grasp how big America is till you live in America.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you have large countries, you know, Germany's not tiny. You know, the UK isn't super tiny. And even though people are very different and they're, you know, they have varying viewpoints and stuff, they're still much more homogenous than the US is because it's so huge and because it's made up of all immigrants. You know, it's
the US is more like all of Europe, you know, and yeah. Europe is not the same. Like Italians are not the same as Germans, you know, like that there's a huge difference. And I feel like that's the US. And you can kind of sense it in the elections and this argument, like people don't want to live the same life. You know, there's really states where I think the people there don't want to live the life that New Yorkers and people from LA live. And of course, there's not one state that has only people like that, but there's definitely half of America that wants to be purist and weirdly Pentecostal and racist.
Yeah.
And
oh yeah,
they would like to live openly white supremacy. And to be fair,
for sure,
I actually prefer people who openly say that. To me, it's easier.
I agree with you in the aspect of, so it's funny because growing up in Boston, which I didn't realize was a city that had a reputation as being racist until I was like an adult. And whenever I thought of like white supremacy and like racism, I always think, you know, just big fat crackers in the South being like, boy, you know, like Boss Hog type guys. And Boston is sort of segregated in a way that's it's like a different flavor of it. So it's hard to equate it the same way. Like on one of my albums, I joke and I say Boston's not racist. It has an artisanal xenophobia in that it's not that you're black. It's that you're not me. It tends to be people here rather than you're somebody else. But, you know, when I was growing up and I was in punk rock bands and we had like neo-Nazi skinheads and all those guys, I never thought I would say this, but I almost respect them more now for being the kind of just like toxic asshole who was like, no, I know my views are vile and I know people are going to fight me about them. And I'm so dedicated and out with this that I'm ready to, you know, I'm almost like that's almost more respectable than the little weaselly nerds and the alt-right people and the people like. They want to have their cake and eat it too. And I'm like, just own it if that's what you're going to do, man.
Yeah. And that's, I think, really hard to do. Like, you know, I heard this story. Thank God I can't remember her name. So therefore I can't say it because I usually don't have a filter. But it's an actress or like a talk show woman who's very well known. And her and her husband kind of, super, you think that they are literally left, not even liberal, but left, right? With all the stuff that she's saying on the show. And then there was this whole story that I read how they are fighting to segregate schools in New York. Like these two are on the board that fight to segregate schools. And I thought that to me is evil. That's truly ill. Like the pretend to be the liberal lefty kind of Hollywood person and make all these jokes about, and then you and your husband are segregating, like making sure your kid doesn't have to go to school. That's to me, I mean, truly 100 times more evil than those idiots, you know?
Absolutely, because you're making money off your image and your persona that isn't real, and you're building a sense of trust with people, and you've built a platform that could do good in the world.
Yeah,
and you're just wasting it.
Correct. And also, like, it's backstabbing, it's two-facing, it's like the worst of the worst. Like, just come out with it, you know. That's why, I mean, people always kind of look when I say that, you know, but there's something about people who act one way and do something else, and
yeah, I mean, that's, again, like, when I've been down south, I've been much less comfortable, and people are like, everyone's nicer here, and I'm like, no, they're not, they're just nicer to your face. Yeah. Whereas here, like, if people have a problem with you, they'll be like, look, you fucking asshole, like, they'll just say it, and then I'm like, okay, they're not just like, oh no, that's great, and then you turn around and they're like, that fucking, you know, I'm like, I'd rather they just get it out of the way. Wait, you know?
Are you in Boston now still?
I am, yeah.
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 You know, I follow this incredible writer from Boston named Dart Adams. Do you follow him?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I, you know, this, like, he's just kind of opened my eyes to what Boston is, because he always writes about Black Boston, you know. And to be fair, because, again, this is a thing about being from Europe and not really, like, you always kind of running behind, you have missed part of the US. Like, you're not quite catching on to American culture, no matter how much you want to. It's just, you're not from here. And I don't actually mind that, but, you know, that's why certain things I really have to, like, learn, you know. And it's so interesting when he tweets about, because, you know, he's right. Like, every movie I've ever seen that Boston plays a part in is the whitest movie on the planet, always.
Yep. You would
think this is mostly where white people live, you know. And then he tweets this stuff, and I'm like, oh, there's a whole other, like, Boston that I don't know about and nobody else does, because we don't show it, we don't make shows about it, we don't make movies about it. And I find that, like, super sad.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's there's a bunch of really fascinating things about Boston from a Black perspective that I've either learned just because of my interest growing up, or really only learned as an adult. And, like, for example, the place where they broke Bob Marley and Jimmy Cliff in America was Boston.
Oh, really? I didn't know that either.
And the reason is very strange. There used to be a movie theater here called the Orson Welles, and it was in Cambridge, and it was one of the first midnight movie theaters.
Uh-huh.
And every Friday night they showed The Harder They Come. And wow, it was so popular that they started importing the soundtrack and selling it at the concessions. Next, people were like, we love this movie, we want the soundtrack. And so the record labels were like, why is all this reggae selling at this one movie theater in Cambridge? So then they were like, they had Jimmy Cliff come and play at that theater. They had Bob Marley come and play at that theater. And so there was this weird little blip of Boston Black culture that embraced reggae in America before anyone else in the entire country.
Wow.
That is just strange.
And, you know, there's many of these stories, I bet you. Like, I'm always thinking, like, God, I wish somebody would give Dart a show, because, you know, I would love to see that. And it's not a diversity thing, it's not an equality thing. It's like, I'm super, and so I'm sure the rest of the world would be, you know, these are worlds that we have not seen, and they belong to this country too. And I think they're just interesting, you know? And to be honest, I would be as interested in that as I am about, for example, I was about Big Love, which was equally interesting to me because, oh, there's, like, you know, these, you know, Mormons that are also,
it's alien. Yeah.
And, you know, I was fascinated, and, you know, I just don't understand why we can't do that. You know, I had another friend who I also met on Twitter. She wrote a script about the place in the Hamptons, which is basically an all-Black neighborhood. And she wrote about it, how that came about in the 50s. I'm like, what? You know, there's, like, a boogie Black neighborhood in the Hamptons where, like, rich Black people. And she wrote this amazing script of how the drive there was the most, you know, feared thing, because they never knew if they would actually get there, you know, if they would get stopped by the police and arrested and stuff. And so I thought that was the most amazing pilot script. I gave that to everybody I knew. And I said, let's make this. Can somebody help her? I really honestly did this work and tried to get this pilot in hands because I wanted to see that show. I so wanted this to be like an HBO show I can tune in on Sunday. Nobody wanted it. And it's to this day, this blows my mind.
It's weird because we were talking about this a little bit before. The money people will only make things that have already made money. So they don't want to be the first one to do a thing. When you have all these unmined stories that are fascinating, they don't want to be the one who sticks their neck out. It's like innovation is not looked at as a benefit in the entertainment industry necessarily, except in hindsight.
You know, once in a while they do let somebody make something that's out of the ordinary. And, you know, I always feel super resentful when I see that, because I already know that when a Breaking Bad, when a Stranger Things, when anything like that gets green lit, it's 100% a white man or multiple men. And it bothers me because, you know, and I make these decisions when I pitch. I've pitched so many remakes or kind of based on this because, and there's executives who told me, it's like, yeah, that's smart to go with that, because they know that it reduces the risk, because there's actually been times where I pitched stuff like Stranger Things, being such a huge 80s fan, and I could just see it's going nowhere. Nobody is going to give me a show where I can celebrate the 80s and bring all my music back and all of that. That's just not going to happen. And so there is a lot of these kind of shows. Like, we are nobody in Hollywood, nobody in the industry doesn't have original ideas. Like, once you're in and you have an agent and you're out, you know, people always say, well, don't Hollywood people have original ideas? No, we all have a lot of original ideas. We don't get to make them. And sometimes you make a decision like I do, where I, you know, I'm not going to go out there and pitch the craziest idea, even though I think it's a great idea. You know, people on Twitter tell me it's a good, but I know what I can sell. I know how much. Like, I walk into the room, I'm a risk for them, you know? And so you kind of like, analyze, like, you know, how can I reduce the risk? And sometimes reducing the risk is going with, you know, a known, like, IP.
I mean, sometimes you have to Trojan horse it too. Like, I remember the best advice I got for pitching stuff, and I've never sold anything, but I've pitched a bunch of stuff, was in it, this sort of made my brain understand how these executives work, is when they said, a person who I was asking who was a showrunner was like, whenever you mention a character, tell the people what actor would play it. Not because you're going to cast that person, because executives can't picture anything. And so if you tell them the actor, then they're like, oh, okay, yeah, I know what that is. So you kind of have to, like, I was like, oh, okay, I get where they're coming from in this now.
That's dangerous too, though, because, you know, people hate each other in Hollywood. That's another thing that outside people don't know. They all hate each other. Like, there's literally, even if you see them together out at an event, and I see a lot of people on Twitter make this assumption. They make it with me all the time, right? Like, they assume that because I made a movie with somebody or because I'm working with somebody, that we are buddies. Like, most likely when people work with each other or they know each other or they're in the same genre, they usually hate each other. Yeah.
Yeah, there's rivalries, and also, yeah, like, they got that thing I didn't, or whatever.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I mean, like, it's a toxic town, and, you know, it just is what it is. But that's why bringing up a name, you don't know what the history is there. You know, you don't know what happened. That kid is probably an executive whose parents were executives, and some, you know, it's just, you never know.
That is true. I never really thought of that. I always end up using older actors too, because that's my frame of reference. So half the time the people I've pitched to are probably like, I don't know who that is. All right. But I always think of, like, the Watchmen series for what we're talking about, because the Watchmen series, which I was a huge fan of the comic book, I hated the Zack Snyder movie, but the series did this brilliant thing where I was ashamed to admit I had never heard of the Black Wall Street Tulsa Massacre. I only heard about it from Watchmen. And Watchmen managed to take an existing IP, not adapt a single thing from it, and tell an amazing story about race in America that was more in keeping with the spirit of the original source material than the movie that was based on it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. I never looked at it that way. I didn't know that there was none of that in the comic books.
None of it. I mean, some of the characters, like, they reuse, but completely original story, completely original takes on it, which is funny because, like, Alan Moore, speaking of Neil Gaiman, Alan Moore was the guy who sort of broke, was responsible for Gaiman really getting into the American comic book market. And Alan Moore is a complete lunatic, and he's completely said, I don't want anything to do with anything being adapted from my work. It's all garbage, which is a different. He always had the same take of, I forget who originally said this, but there was a famous author that their work was starting to be adapted. And someone asked him, like, you know, Hollywood's ruining your books. Aren't you upset they're ruining your books? And he said, no, they're all right here on the shelf. They're all fine. which is Alan Moore. His attitude was that, but then he started not thinking that. And he missed out on Watchmen, because I'm like, that series would have been what you wanted to be adapted from your work, but he checked out, you know?
Yeah. Sad.
It's very strange. But so you were in Germany, and then for the, you know, 2 years, and then not the summers, then you came here specifically to compete in tournaments, right? Is that what kind of brought you here?
I kind of retired already. I did a couple in the US, but I was, I had become world champion. And then at some point, you know, the Americans were always kind of invited to give us, like, they would, like, people like Chuck Norris and some of the famous ones, Bill Wallace, you know, Pat Johnson, they would...
Superfoot.
Yeah, they would pop up at these tournaments and, like, give the grand champions trophies. And you kind of, like, you know, that's its own subculture. At least it was. I'm not sure. I think it changed a little bit since then. but, you know... yeah, it was its own subculture where we knew all the famous ones and the ones that were... once in a while in movies, you know, and that was also like a time where there was still this huge market for direct-to-video movies, and there was no shame in that, right? We loved that these movies, like, directly, especially when you live in Europe, you don't want a whole movie, like, released in a theater in the US, and then it has to get dubbed, and then it has to come to Europe. It takes a long time at the time. So we loved that it was straight to video, and it came really fast, and we would watch, like, Don the Track and Wilson, and there was this whole, like, genre of, you know, real martial artists, none of them really great actors, working in these movies. And you know, it was kind of like when you were a good martial artist, it was something to look forward to either go into stunts and maybe, if you're lucky, get a few movies yourself. And so I think, you know, at some point, one of them asked me, it's like, oh, you want to come? And they innocently did this with a lot of people that they thought had, you know, potential. And that was really nice that they kept inviting us to the U.S. to join kind of this kind of, you know, community. And I did, you know, my green card was sponsored by, you know, Bill Wallace and Chuck Norris, and Chuck and I don't really see eye to eye on politics. Yeah. We haven't talked in a long time. So, but you know, they did sponsor my green card, and I started in stunts first. I was Princess Katana in the Mortal Kombat live tour. I think in that live tour, there was, I think, 40, 50 martial artists together. Some of them were from Poland. Some of them were from Asia. Like, it was really great, you know? Yeah, and then I think my first part that I got that was kind of like a stunt acting part was in Batman and Robin, and Joel Schumacher promptly fired me.
You didn't like the work you were doing?
No, it was... you know, to be honest, at the time, like, I was crying my eyes out. It was so shocking to me. We had to have, I don't know if you remember the film, but it had these, like, colors, weird colors, right? And
yep.
I was basically one of the golems in that swimming pool. The main golem who was cast was Doug Hutchison, right? And we were the golems around. We had to do the whip chain. So it was basically a stunt acting part. Now, I knew the stunt coordinator really well, and I had to teach the other guys the whip chain. They actually didn't know how to do it, right? And so I taught them the whip chain, but then we had to have, when we were shooting, we had to have these contact lenses in, and these contact lenses would basically make our eyes under black light glow.
And so were they the scleral lenses, like the whole ones that go over your whole entire eye that hurt really bad?
They weren't that big. Maybe they were going over the entire, I can't remember. I do remember that they could never get them in my eye. My eye would just kind of tear them out it wasn't something I could control. And so
right.
I guess I was always a little bit late because they had trouble getting my contact in. And then one day I was just fired for nothing other than the contact lens is really hard to get into my eye and I was tearing a lot and stuff. So here's the thing, and that would not go today anymore. Joel Schumacher, who's famously gay man, right?
Oh, yeah, very.
Me with a guy. He replaced this part with a guy, you know, and I just was stunned that that was possible. And the guy didn't know how to do whip chain. So the guys I taught the whip chain to had to teach him the whip chain. And the best part is if you look back at the scene, can't actually tell who's a guy and a girl. So it wasn't even like a matter, like it didn't matter. We all had these big jackets on and whatnot. But Doug Hutchison, who was the actor in that role, who had worked with Joel Schumacher on that other film about racists, I think it had one of the Baldwins in it playing a lawyer. I'm not.
Oh, yes. Yeah. It's not Mississippi Burning, but it's
something like that.
I can't think. Yeah.
Anyway, so he was the main actor, and he was so shocked that I was fired. That he and the rest of the guys like wrote me this really nice card and sent it to me of how sorry they are. And he especially is like, I'm so sorry this happened, but it happens to all of us. Just so you know, I got fired. Please stay in touch. I thought you were so talented and patient in teaching each other. And that stayed in my mind so much that he sent that card that I cast him in Punisher Warzone as LBJ. And he didn't know that. He didn't know that's who I was until the first day on set. He went out of his mind. He couldn't believe it. You know?
That's why you should be nice to people.
I know. I kind of tend to do that always. Like, I mean, it'll be like some name will come up on the list of the casting director. I'm like, oh my God, I remember that guy was really nice. That's like a thing, especially for me. I mean, I really want to, because I can just see the conflict coming, and I've had it before. Like, you know, Queen Street was kind of not a great time for me. Like that all went to, you know, and so I'm now really like thinking, you know, who can I get? Like, who's not giving me a fucking nightmare every day? You know?
Right. Really, but that's why.
Yeah. So
people like Bonnie Hunt has become a friend. Since doing the show, and Bonnie's someone who's like one of my heroes, and she's like never comes up when people talk about like women in Hollywood who really did it their way, but she has a crew that she always uses now because it's like, those are the people, they're super loyal. Everyone's like, she's whittled it down to like, these are the people. And you kind of have to do that to your point, because.
Yeah. You know, and every time I do a movie, I learn that lesson. This time I really paid attention who the cast is, and I lucked out. I didn't have a bad egg in that whole cast. Like, they were all super good people. They've all become close friends. There wasn't like a diva in the mix, blah, blah. But I didn't pay that much attention to cast. That's not actually to crew. I paid attention to crew, but what happened is, and there's not a lot of people talk about that either, you know, there's so much content being made right now. It's actually mind-blowing how much content there's being made.
Yeah.
And, you know, we didn't really pay attention to bringing more people in. The union keep people out all the time. I've tried to get a couple of people into the union on my show, and they just said no. And this is, I'm talking below the line crew. This is not necessarily the kind of jobs that you dream your whole life of, like this is like,
yeah, hard. A DP or, yeah.
But it's
hard. It's like grips and electricians.
Yeah. And like, you know, hair and makeup, this is all long hours, hard work, you know, and, you know, produce production coordinates, line producers and stuff. And so once you have the top, like, I would say, you know, 12 people working, you're now going into territory of new people who are untrained or people who obviously haven't been hired on the, like, you really, that pool of like, these people are great at this job and they are kind and they are responsible. That is not a big pool, and they are very busy. They
go no.
from one project to the other. And so now you are hunting, right? And I think I don't want to give away what it is, but there's been a few positions where I think we offered at least 12 people the job. Now, this was a Netflix movie and not a small one, right? I mean, small compared to most, but also not super indie, you know. But, you know, we could not get, they also like TV shows better because that's a longer paycheck and people are like,
yeah,
now, and I get that. But I thought, my God, you know, surely a Netflix movie, like, we could not get anybody arrested. And now you actually starting to get into, at some point you realize, if I don't pull the trigger now, if this movie doesn't go, I'm not making this movie. And boy, sure enough, on this last movie, that certainly was the case, because all the press that came out from Netflix after was, when we were basically shooting, was, yeah, we're not making those movies anymore.
Yeah, everything's canceled. Yeah.
So I was like, oh my God, oh my God. So it was good that finally I said, I got to get going. I can't wait anymore. And, but you start making compromises in certain positions. And boy, when I tell you, you know, there's so much power that some people have over you. You think it's all, or like if you a writer, director, and a producer on a project, surely you have all the power. But that's not the case. I don't have that kind of power. I can't just fire somebody. Not only because there is nobody, but also there is nobody to replace that person.
Right.
They have a lot of power. They can really
leverage
you. Yeah.
And it's leverage. It's
Yeah, it's wild. It's what's going on. So Bonnie Hunt, I have to meet her. She sounds like a smart woman. That kind of character is not usually does not have a good time in Hollywood because it's not
is
admired or respected.
Nope.
And it rubs people the wrong way. I get it because I'm like that. I'm always very kind of you know, black and white. It's like, hey, we know all the rules. We know we're not supposed to hurt people, discriminate people. Why don't we just stick to them? And it really, for me, it's very black and white. And it isn't at all for Hollywood people. And so now you start either compromising your own integrity, which I'm not willing to do, or you start having fights. And I'm telling you, it's hard for me because every time my phone rings and my agents have a want to have a conference call with all of them and my lawyer on the phone, my heart drops because I know they're going to call me because somebody called them. And then I have to like, I'm laughing because every time I scream this on the phone, all of you have daughters. Why don't you get that? I'm also fighting for your daughters.
Yeah.
I don't know how many times I've screamed this, but there's just this thing of like, you know, you can change things, but in a polite manner and in a manner that doesn't really change anything.
Yeah, it makes them feel like they're changing. It's like a very cursory sort of superficial sort of, you know, they're okay with that, but not substantive is a little bit more the growing pains of that is in saying no to stuff, you know, as someone who's turned down things and people are, you're crazy. I'm like, I don't want to do that. Like, you know, I could do that and be a failure and feel bad that I did that or not do that and be a failure and at least not feel bad that I did that. You know, like, so it's, that's always how I look at it.
I don't understand how miserable it is. But on the other side, I mean, I've said yes to stuff that aren't not to stuff that I absolutely hate. I actually pass on so many things, but I've said yes to stuff that isn't necessarily fair that I would watch, you know, where I'm thinking, well, you know, I don't hate this. And I'm kind of almost like, I respect that they asked me because obviously, you know, their show that hasn't asked a lot of women or are trying to be. And so I'm kind of like, you know, I should just do this. And also I need to pay rent. Okay. There is.
Yeah. A gig's a gig in that regard. Yeah.
So I've done that. So there's that part too. But yeah, it's certainly, it's hard. Hollywood is a really tough industry when you have principles.
Yeah, and especially like the era that you were kind of coming up in the 90s, you know, as sort of as a martial arts nerd and as a stunt nerd as well. And as someone who was really into Hong Kong action movies as a kid, because we had a Shaw Brothers theater in Chinatown in Boston. Wow. And it was one of the few Shaw Brothers built theaters in America. And when I was a kid, like 10, 11, it was kind of in disrepair, but it was still there. And I would go and I would watch like Hard Boiled and Golden Harvest movies because they weren't dubbed. I had no idea what was going on, but I'm like, these are incredible. And you're seeing this action stuff that we didn't start to get in US movies until the mid to late 90s when they started importing all those people over here, like Yuen Biu and all those people to like choreograph things. But that old Hollywood stuntman 70s and 80s crew who are kind of good old old boys. There's some good guys in there too, but there was like a weird network of like, well, I'm going to hire my daughter-in-law and this guy.
That's still ongoing.
Yeah.
They're families. And not only that, it actually got worse. I was reading that story in that TV guide about, you know, that guy. And it's actually interesting. There must have been a phase where a lot happened. But then we had a fairly safe phase. And lately it's been going crazy again. And I tell you why that is because really, ever since all these streaming places opened, you know, people don't realize how much content is getting made. There is a lot of work. That's why I also think that, you know, people shouldn't be silly about, you know, promoting inclusion and working on it, because really, honestly, there's a lot of work for all of us. Is it always fair? Is it always easy to get in? No. But, you know, really, there is enough. So if you keep the gates down and you would make it fair, you know, we could all survive, unless you're lazy and untalented, but nobody wants to admit that.
Right. Then you should not be working anyway. Yeah. It's your point. So the issue that I gave you, there's an article in there in 85 about there was 4 or 5 deaths on sets at that time. Not even counting the Twilight Zone, the movie thing, which happened that same year, which was a nightmare. But you had John Eric Hexum on the set of a movie, shot himself in the head with a blank gun. You had, 3 or 4 other deaths, and 85 and now, and this hadn't occurred to me until you just said this, are actually very similar in the thirst for content, because in 85 you had this nexus of time where cable was coming into its own and producing original stuff for the first time. You still had drive-ins, you had direct-to-video starting to really kick up, you had all the studios still, so you had everybody making content, and you don't have necessarily the safest or least reckless people working, because you need to make all these things.
I didn't know that about 85, but now it makes complete sense, because I can tell you what happened now. And it's like, when I say now, I really mean this is like 3-4 years ago, where I saw this happening and I said, oh, accidents will happen. Because stunt people are, you know, they don't, a lot of them don't go, I would say the majority, don't go out and try to find new people and think, you know what, there's so much stuff happening, I'm so busy, my family is complaining that I'm never there, why don't I just train some people? Like, they're not those type of people. First, most stunt people want to have every job themselves, because, you know, they probably tried really hard to get there, so now they're like, why don't I do all 4 shows, right? And then suddenly they start realizing, shit, I can't do that anymore. And now, you know, the showrunners will ask them, like, can you find somebody else? Who else is good in this place? I'm not saying Canada, but, you know, let's just say Canada.
Could be.
And so now that stunt guy will go. And instead of saying, I'm going to recruit somebody who I know is safe, who maybe comes from a different profession, but like, let's say somebody who, I don't know, trains skydivers, or somebody who comes from an industry of safety, who is a good like head of department, because as the stunt coordinator, your biggest concern must be safety. There's a lot of people who can do a lot of crazy shit. Your responsibility is to keep them all safe, right? But oh no, he will go, and he will go pick up this 25-year-old dude who's his friend, because that's a big thing. It's like, you don't want to give a stranger the job that brings so much money. You're going to give it to your dude who will be forever grateful. And then when he's big, he will throw you a job. But it's not thought through, okay? And what blows my mind is that people don't check. Like, just because you're a stunt choreographer who's doing your 3 other shows is making the suggestion, why don't you check what this person he's suggesting has done, okay? I mean, I've directed one show once where I, you know, coming from having been a stunt woman, I can obviously see things. And, you know, I saw the rigging coordinator do stuff that I thought, somebody's going to die for sure. And somebody really got hurt on that show. And part of me kind of felt like maybe I should have spoken up. But, you know, there would have been no, if I would have just randomly said, I saw this guy prepare a rig and it was dangerous and I know it. Like, imagine what would have happened. They would have just said, what the fuck is she doing? Like, she's not supposed to snitch.
Mind your business.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so.
Oh yeah, no, I'm the same way. It's I hate this time of year because I'm like, allergies, or do I have COVID? I hope it's not COVID because
I know I don't have COVID because I'm literally not seeing anybody.
Yeah, same thing with me. I never leave the house at this point, so I'm like, yeah, yeah. It's a fascinating thing in the. You know, I'm friends with Cynthia Rothrock, and hearing her story about like almost the reverse of yours, where she got discovered at a tournament, and then all of a sudden, 2 days later, is a star at Golden Harvest and doesn't speak Chinese, has no clue what, and it's just insane. There,
I always looked up to her. I thought, I mean, she was the only woman doing this stuff. You know,
and yeah.
For a lot of us, she kind of gave us hope. You know that. You know, it was very funny. People always said, oh, to me, and this was really in a time when I had just won. I was always doing these photos with the splits the same way Jean-Claude Van Damme. I mean, we all did them, but, you know, yeah. People came to me and said, you really should be the female Jean-Claude Van Damme. And I thought, oh, yeah, well, why not? That'll make a lot of money and be in storytelling. And I very quickly realized that I could never, ever be an actor. Like, there was just too much waiting around. I didn't like audition. I do remember, though, when I was doing stunt work, I did go to a lot of auditions. That was kind of part of it. You were kind of doing both. I remember, like, they would say things afterwards like, yeah, her acting was great, and she's great, but, you know, her legs are way too muscular. Like, they just say that stuff straight up.
Yeah, right in front of you.
And it was just like, I thought, there's no way I can do this, because you would have to have so much self-esteem to not go crazy. I said, I don't have that. And also, like, it feels very like you really do feel like a puppet, you know, and it's one like on strings with no, like a marionette, you know, like with no control, you know. And that's immediately when I switched to like, I got to learn how to direct, because I did want
Which is
to
be very smart.
In filmmaking, you know, but I knew I wasn't going to do the thing. But back in the day when I was really young, Cynthia Rothrock was kind of like, she would even make the idea that there could be a female Van Damme possible, because she was it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, her, she has just crazy, but she's also very like super easygoing that I'm in a way that I'm not. Like, she's told me stories. She's like, yeah, no, and I flew out and then I was just doing the scene. And I think the first movie she did was Inspector Wears Skirt with Michelle Yeoh. And the way they did movies in China at that time, it was like, what are my lines? Oh, you don't have any. Just come in and yell at this guy. Well, what am I yelling? Doesn't matter. We dub it in later. You know, it was like very carefree, you know? And then they'd just be like, and then you guys fight. And she's like, well, what do we? No, you just fight each other and then we'll film it. And that's it. Like, it was very seedy your pants. So I think that is.
Because they are the ones who started all the like very kind of, intense choreographies that take like 6 weeks, you know, not the sharp necessarily, but they definitely had, you know, I mean, I think they taught us how to choreograph fights, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, I remember I was watching
British shows, and you can just tell, like, they'll have, or German shows as well, like, you can tell that they didn't call a stunt coordinator, right? They just said, punch that person there, and they don't want to hurt somebody. So it's literally like the wrestlers do with the, like, punch.
Yeah.
Like, I'm like, could they not just call somebody in and, like, you know, but they just sometimes skip it completely, you know?
I get super nerdy, and it. My wife's like, what are you talking about? But one of my favorite things about fight coordination is when the fight coordinator comes up with a specific style for that character based on their character, you know? I was talking to, oh my God, I'm James Liu. And James Liu had just done Luke Cage. And he was saying, oh yeah, the style I came up with for Luke Cage, I called slap foo, because this guy's not a trained fighter. He's just super strong. So he's going to develop the style where he's just kind of slapping people around. Yeah. And I'm like, that's, people don't care about that, or they don't consciously, but that stuff makes stuff so much more interesting. Like that Jet Li movie, The One. Have you ever seen that movie?
Which one? Oh yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. The alternate universe things. So each version of himself in that movie has a different kung fu style.
Yeah.
And then as he absorbs their powers, he incorporates that style into the choreography of the movie going forward.
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, that's super nerdy and awesome. But
most of us do that. I don't think I've met any. I mean, yeah, there's a lot of thought about, like, I had a whole website up for my stunt coordinators, and I almost felt like, oh, I hope they're not offended by this, but they weren't, where I like literally this is his style, this is why, you know, it's a mix of this and this. And like, I literally had a whole fucking like philosophy, like a dogma. Why did time is to be like that? And then got really picky about it when they were showing me previews. And I was like, no, that's not, he would not fucking do a flying backfist. That's the opposite.
That's not his style.
Flying backfist is an asshole move. And, you know, and an interesting one, but it's like a show off move. It's like a, it's like, yeah, somebody flashy does that. You know, nobody who's like a fighter who really doesn't want to fight unless he has to fight. Your hero is not gonna, you know, flying back to,
yeah,
somebody. And so,
look at me, everybody.
Yeah. And they were laughing because I was, well, not always laughing. I think at a certain point I probably got very annoying for them. But you know, that's the part where you just insist on your vision, and you know, it gets,
you're in charge at that point. So we were talking about like what American shows got to like where you grew up, and it tends to be action shows that we would export because comedy doesn't travel very well. So I imagine it was, I mean, is Norm Macdonald correct saying that Germans love David Hasselhoff? Like, was Knight Rider huge?
No, not me, but they did. I mean, and I can see why, because listen, they still dress like him in the 80s. Like, they still have the, like, he was the, like, mullet. And, you know, like, that was just a big thing. We had this car called Opel Manta, which really everybody made fun of, right? But it was that typical, like, I think the Fiero Pontiac would be closest here. Like, it was, it just, you can't really afford, like, a sports car that's, like, from a, you know, great car brand, but the Fiero, right, Pontiac, and now you're making it like work, you know,
like an IROC Z.
And so, or the like, you know, Volkswagen Scirocco was a little bit like that. I don't know if you've had that either, but anyway, so those, and it was, you know, they had the mullet and, you know, the fucking red leather jackets,
shoulder pads.
And so he was kind of like the, if you think back, like, he was the noble version of that, right? Like, the kind of,
yeah,
noble, but the kind of the rich man's version of it. And everybody else tried to be the poor man's version of it. And so, and the Germans, because I think that, you know, the 80s were so big. The 80s was also a good time for Germany. Because remember, we had, like, you know, Falco, who was really Austrian, but we claimed him. We had Nena. Like, there was a lot of German bands that were, you know, internationally huge.
Yeah.
And that's never happened since and before, you know, it was the 80s. And so I, in my mind, I think that a lot of Germans for the longest time were stuck in the 80s. You go back to that town that I grew up in, you still see some stuck in the 80s, like fashion-wise. Like, they just moved on a tiny bit. Like, they moved on from the mullet at some point, but just a little bit, you know? And the fashion and stuff, you can still see it. Same cars and stuff. And so I think that's why he was so popular. But, you know, there was one in the TV guide there that I recognized immediately, but boy, it had a different name. It certainly didn't have that name. Something in Scarecrow, it's called here.
Oh, Scarecrow and Mrs. King.
Yes, Scarecrow and Mrs. King. That's not what it was called in German, but I love that show. I love that show. I mean, just the idea that he's always picking up this mother. Whereas I think, and
oh, yeah.
I think also in there was Remington. There was a whole piece about Remington Steel in there. Now, you know, yeah, me, and I think you've heard me talk about this on Twitter, right? I'm obsessed with Remington Steel because people don't realize this. You could still make that show today and it would be true. And that's a real shame. And I tell you this as somebody who has actually pulled, I've sold things and under male names. I have done that, you know?
Yeah. For people that don't remember, it's kind of a feminist show in a lot of ways, but the premise of Remington Steel for Lister was you had this woman who was in charge of a detective agency. No one took her seriously, so she made up a male owner who was like a super detective named Remington Steel and hired Pierce Brosnan's character, who was an actor, to play this role. And he was just a buffoon playing this like super detective, like, and she was the real brains.
He was a male, yeah, bimbo. That's what he was. He was good-looking but stupid. And she was the, yep, whole brain, and of course, everybody always trusted him. I mean, it was actually, I remember how frustrating it got, because every episode you kept thinking somebody's going to find out and she gets all the credit, and she never did. And then he gets the fucking girl on top of it. But what I always think about all the time is that this could still, you could make that show right now and it would still count. Mm-hmm. And that's a shame, you know?
Yeah, that's zero progress whatsoever.
None.
And the novelty of it is still a novelty, which is ridiculous.
I know. It's crazy. Yeah, and then he went on to become super famous. The other one I remember is in Germany it was called Hart aber Ehrlich. And I think here it was called The Hearts. It was a couple.
Oh, Heart to Heart.
Yep. Heart to Heart. So here it was called Heart to Heart. In Germany it was called Hard but Truthful. I don't know what.
Okay.
I know.
True Hearts, like Sweethearts. Yeah. What was Scarecrow Mrs. King called?
I can't remember, but not that. I have to look it up. Yeah, it's going to take me a while to research.
It's funny because, like, there are some shows that to get on DVD, I had to get them from Germany, American shows. One of them is Misfits of Science, which is in this issue. And was an it was basically the X-Men in 1984. Courtney Cox was in it. Nobody liked it here. It was a huge bomb. But the whole series came out on DVD in Germany like 10 years ago. So I was like, was this popular in Germany?
Do you know what it was called in Germany?
I do. Let me look. It is called... Oh my God, I'm not even going to try to pronounce this because you'll hate me. I don't know if you can see this.
Die Spezialisten unterwegs. Aha. Interesting. I'm going to ask around if somebody... you know, there's so many geeks. There's a website in Germany, and I do enjoy going on there. I'm sure you know, because I always tweet about... It's not my favorite country, actually. I had a lot of time being an Arab. I had a lot of time, times growing up there, so... But there are still some things that I can't help but just enjoy because it's also been my home country, a painful one, but it's kind of a love-hate relationship. They have this web. They are, again, like I told you, still stuck a little bit in the 80s. There's so much nostalgia about Gen X. It's crazy. And there's multiple websites, but one specifically, and they talk for hours about all the great shows in the 80s. And they will pull out everything that I have long forgotten and talk about it. Oh, remember this? And they'll have the DVD, the VHS, and the everything that, and they'll like know this actor and know what all the other actors went to. Like they're really obsessed with that stuff.
What's like a quintessential German 80s show that you watched growing up that like we wouldn't know about here?
I don't know if it was anything produced there. I mean, there's a lot of kids stuff. I think they were really good with stuff for youth and kids. That's, I have to say, I miss it. Like, for example, you know, we had in summer, the program, the TV program would go during the day into basically what you would call summer program. And a lot of shows for kids would be played. And they even had a host. So it was basically, I as a kid whose, you know, parents were not there all day. Now you have vacation.
That's me. Right?
Yeah. And now you are like not in school and all your friends are on vacation somewhere. I didn't have a grandma to go to. I was in Jordan, but there was always this piece of the vacation that basically I was home alone. Everybody else was gone. You know, and you had nothing to do whatsoever. And, you know, remember, this is also in a time where you didn't have like a stack of DVDs or whatever, you know?
Right.
And they put that program on that basically ran from morning to evening, almost like it was the Olympics, with a host that was specially, two hosts that were specially for this program. And they would talk between the shows and then it would be one children's show after another. And that's how I think, to be honest, that's really where I, you know, kind of had the thought of like, I want to do this. I want to do a show like that. I think if I wouldn't have had that, I don't think I would be in this business now. So they did something good. And that's really where they succeeded the most. Anything to do, like I could, there was a show with this little, like gnome that had red hair and he was animated, but he popped up in the world of a live action, like Carpenter.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, and I'll show you a clip. And to this day, like, and if you say to a German, do you know Pumuckl? Everybody knows Pumuckl. And it was just a lovely show. And honestly, this is where they most succeed. Never Ending Story is a German book. There was one called Momo, yep, which didn't become as famous here. But there's a lot of that. And then there's another thing they did, which I always thought somebody should do here. They did this thing called like a 6-episode miniseries, and it was always over Christmas. So you would know that a week before Christmas, you know, these episodes start, and they would basically be spread out in the week that we call in between years, which basically is Christmas and New Year's. Also because the Germans would literally shut everything down for like 5 days,
yeah,
or something. Like I,
most of Europe would do that. England did that too. It was like Holy Week, exactly, or whatever it is. Yeah.
And so they were, and everybody watched that. And talking about England, you know, I remember being there, and this was just a few years ago, and I have family there, and like we were in this, it was also during Christmas time, and we were in this pub having like Sunday roast, you know. And then you just saw this crowded pub suddenly go boop, 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 boop. Every table was like, you know, getting empty at the same time. It's like, the fuck is this place closing? And I remember my sister-in-law said, explained to me, no, Doctor Who special is on. We have to like,
yep, too.
And I thought it was so fascinating because you knew the whole nation was watching this, no matter who. And I came back and I remember bringing this up to a few executives. I've said this forever. Like, I don't get why they, especially network TV, and again, I pitch these things, but they don't get through, you know. And somebody, and see, this is where I like crow a lot of resentment, because I pitch this stuff all the time and people just like ignore me and, you know, wave me out of the room. And then somebody will come, and somebody is usually like a young white guy, a middle-aged white guy,
yeah,
and he will pitch that and they'll think he's a genius. And then I have to watch everybody like, oh my God, like what a genius, and frustrating as hell. But this is, yeah, this makes so much sense to me, because we've already seen it when they did like the musical, the Romeo, I think was it Wizard of Oz, that was with all these black actors, yep, and stuff. Like, event TV for network would be the savior for network. Like, I don't know why they don't, yep, do that. And there's so much we could do, so much. Like, there could be movies of the week that are specifically for Gen X, like going back, and mm-hmm, you don't always have to spend $50 million on something, but you can just try. Like, you can try and do, like, can we do a little event around this? All of us would tune in. Like, Gen X's obsession with their youth is completely ignored, you know? But
oh, yeah. It's funny because I say this too about those. So the studios, the networks don't have day and date TV, scripted TV anymore that draws the audience. You have to see it. We all have to see it tomorrow, which is why we got shows like America's Got Talent and, you know, all those shows, because they're essentially live. If you want to watch it because there's a winner, and if it gets revealed, you don't want to watch it after that, like a sporting event. And so they've been trying to crack that code of, what can we do that's not a competition that would pull in that same audience, which is why they did the live musical events. But to your point, I think they already have that model of the event miniseries that they've been doing since the 70s with things like Roots and North and South and V and all these things that were 4-night events, you know, which is basically the model that Netflix uses for limited series. But it's like studios. That works. You did this.
Put them around, and also like use the times, like actually look at the seasons. Even though America doesn't have as much holiday as England and Germany, they still have, like, they still, you know, Christmas is still an event here. And by the way, you don't always have to make it around these. Like, I'm kind of thinking, like, why isn't anybody thinking of like doing a Ramadan special event series? Like, you know, just let somebody do it, see how it goes. You know, you could probably do the same thing, you know, something about that has to do with the Jewish holidays. And that it doesn't have to be religious, but you have to remember that people are at home. It's festive for them. Give them something that they can watch. It doesn't always have to be Christmas. And then there's also other times that, you know, you kind of like, you know, Americans are more willing to like say, okay, let's make this a thing, you know. And even without seasons, you know, if you say there's like, if there's a specific thing that we all think about, that was like a big thing for us, right? And you have like an, you know, just a one-time TV movie about that, just to kind of pop back into it, into that world, we all would tune in, you know?
And absolutely. It's
not going to cost that much money. Definitely mini-series about certain things, you know? I don't get it. And that whole thing about Doctor Who, you know, there's existing shows here that have been going on forever, and I never get why they don't just make... The British people always have these Christmas specials. Everybody watches them and then buys them on fucking five different outlets. Like, Like, why aren't we doing that? You know,
it's a thing they're doing. Like, they've somehow managed to associate Star Wars with Christmas now. They'll be like, oh yeah, Star Wars, a Christmas thing, which is, we had things like that growing up. Like Wizard of Oz was associated with Christmas here because they'd air it on TV at Christmas, and it has nothing to do with Christmas. But in the pre-video age, like, that's when you watch Wizard of Oz. And that's kind of what the UK has done with Doctor Who, because those Christmas specials aren't necessarily, some of them are Christmas content, but for the most part, they're not. But now people go, Doctor Who, Christmas. So they come to expect it, and they link those things, and now you have that built-in
audience.
They
have it for every show. Like, there's so many shows that people here don't even watch. Like, they will have a Hercule Poirot Christmas special. Every show, you know, Vera has a Christmas special. Every show has a Christmas special because they know that people tune in. And maybe that's because Germany, France, England are smaller countries, but I don't know. I feel like when the few times that it happened here, which was mostly, I think, the one I can remember is The Wizard of Oz, with that just happened not too long ago.
Oh, The Wiz. Yeah.
Right? I mean, look at, it was fucking live tweeted. It had huge numbers. And they're always talking about how there's no better opportunity than the Super Bowl to have an ad, but you could create Super Bowls. You know, with scripted TV, you could create your own Super Bowl. I don't understand why people don't understand that.
I don't either. Like, I think people forget this. No one watched the Super Bowl kind of until the 80s. Do you know what the two most viewed sporting events in the United States on television was from the dawn of television until about the late 70s?
No.
Wrestling and bowling.
Oh, wow. Because I never knew that.
Massive, millions of people, because they were the first things on TV because they were so easy to shoot. You lock down the cameras, people aren't moving, it's one person, and they were huge. Like, bowlers in the 70s in America made millions of dollars. Like,
wow.
huge ratings. And then they caught up and they started realizing they could do, you know, team events, but they're much bigger productions. But that didn't start until the 70s or 80s, because people listened to too.
What about baseball?
Yeah. Baseball was a radio game. Like, people grew up listening to baseball on the radio. So even when baseball was on TV, you had this generation of people who were like, nah, you listen to that on the radio. I don't watch that on TV. So that really didn't even get huge till the 80s. So people forget that, like, the Super Bowl, for like the first 20 of them, were like, no one really cared that much. Like, they built that up. Like, you can build things like that up.
Yeah.
But people's memories are so short, you know, or they don't want to do the work. Or,
well, I think that if you have an IP that everybody recognizes, I mean, I could pitch 10 right now, and I'm sure every Gen Xer could, like, where, like, what world would you like to, you know, dip into just for one evening? Because you know what it is, and this is what always happens. It's like every time I tweet something about Gen X, whether it's about a toy or stuff, it's like, I really, you know, should do it more often. It's just kind of because I also follow so many people in countries where they're having a tough time. It's hard for me to kind of...
It's hard for the trivial stuff, the stuff that seems lighter. I have the same thing.
I think everybody kind of has that conflict with Twitter, because we do want it to be light sometimes. I like the light moments. I need them.
Yeah.
Right? But you do start feeling guilty, because it'll be like when somebody's dropping bombs in Gaza, because there's always something from me. It just feels like you kind of feel guilty when you have people from those countries, you know, following you.
Yeah, and you're like, hey, look at Teddy Ruxpin. Hey, guys. And they're like, oh, we're all dead.
Like, whenever I do tweet something, I can always, like, these are the most popular tweets, and I can always... you know, the kind of solidarity that happens between Gen Xers, right? That pop up in your mentions when you've, you know, tweeted something about, you know, a certain time, a certain movie, a certain toy, anything like that. It's just amazing. And it's like they want to hang out and they want to talk more about it. And I feel the same way, you know, and I can just tell that if we were to you know, make these events that kind of like, that basically are nostalgia events for us, you know, it would be great. And I honestly, it would be a kind of great thing. Stranger Things was introducing kids from today to the 80s. And it's cool that Push is number one. I love that, you know. And that's a good thing. And I love that the fashion all came back. It was neat to see. Like, trust me, I had to fix more 80s watches and 80s toys for my nephews. And
I bet.
In the last year, it was crazy. So that was neat. But it wasn't really for us because I think we lived it. But we would like to think, we would like to go back to an actual event. Like, for example, I was really looking forward to Coming Home, the thing. It was a big letdown. I don't know what the fuck happened there, because I feel like if you do get the money, like, do something great with it. And honestly, I don't like dissing things. I really was the first one counting the days because I love that movie. And I wanted that movie to happen. It just wasn't great. And it bothered me because I feel like how do you not see that that was great? Although I guess it does happen. Like, you know, you just don't know, but it felt to me, and I could be wrong about that, it felt to me like somebody cashed a big check and didn't really.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, one of the problems you have with period pieces, and it's strange to me that I can say 80s things are period pieces, is they try to pay too much lip service to the time. And they also almost always miss that when you're setting something in the past, everything in the show doesn't have to be from that year. That's not how it was. In 1984, everyone's house didn't only have things from 1984. They probably had things that were 20 years old, some 30s, or things. Like, it's a mixture of things that made, that's how it was. And it's like,
America, the rim, I don't know what you call it, not the sequel. I guess you call it a sequel. They were putting it in this time. And I'm actually not sure if that ever works. Like, can you put things into from back then, because what we liked back then is it's precisely all those, you know, all those jokes we always see about, like, this is how we used to block people by just putting the phone down and stuff. Like, that's what fascinates us. What fascinates us is we didn't have even answer machines. You had to go fucking knock on somebody's house and ask, can Timmy come out to play? You know, there's no.
Yeah, and it's. Well, it's like the people who are like, look, if you had so almost every movie and TV show we love would not have the plot if cell phones existed. And it's like, so I think it's the movie The Ice Harvest from a few years back, the John Cusack movie, which is a pretty good movie. It's like sort of a crime heist movie. It was based on a book that was written in the 80s and it was set contemporarily. And they did a really brilliant thing because they basically had everyone's cell phones break within the first 2 minutes. Like, someone slips, it breaks, because you couldn't tell the story if they worked.
Yeah.
So they have to address it. And I think that's part of it too. You know, I think you have to find a way to tell new stories. It's like, I'm a huge George Romero fan. Like, his movies are one of my favorite things. And he didn't do anything good in the 21st century for a variety of reasons, which was, you know, backing what he pitched, but he tried, and he tried to do a found footage movie about the living dead, and it was kind of called Dire Dead. And it just doesn't work because the allegories that he worked in were 20th century allegories.
Yeah.
And they don't work with 21st century stuff.
It's actually interesting to see, like, what then makes sense. Do we actually go back and set it in that time? I tell you one movie that really worked for me. I thought it was the cutest movie, was Music and Lyrics. Have you seen it?
Yes.
That to me, and I know she loves to make those 80s movies. She's like a real 80s kid and stuff. And she's done a few that didn't work. Like the one with Adam Sandler, I don't think worked. Okay. But
The Wedding Singer, that one?
Yeah. That one really worked. And I think it's because it made a little bit fun of like the 80s one hit wonders, but then kind of went back to the redemption of, like, you know, people really did have, you know, talent and stuff. It just,
yeah.
I love that movie. I think there's so much more. And even, let's say you don't put it in our time and you go back into that time, that's not a bad thing either, you know? Either way, like, I mean, I can see it because, you know, people are buying, you know, I'm always like looking of what people are buying in the vintage sphere. If I ever find a good website to sell my own stuff, I will. But these websites are horrible. Like,
oh yeah, that's why I don't sell stuff. Like, there's so much stuff I don't need that I'm like, I want this to go to a good home. But I'm like, it's the few times I've sold stuff online, it's just a nightmare.
Oh my God, it's like, it's really horrible. And I really like need to get, I don't think I'm going to stay in the US or in LA forever. And I really need to start getting rid of stuff. But, you know, these sites, I just don't know. But I do watch all the time because I'm so curious. I also, as a filmmaker, I think you kind of like have to keep your finger on the pulse, like, and see what's going on. And I could sense the nostalgia thing happen. Like, I always knew it would happen, which is why in every town I ever shot, I picked up what people always thought was trash, from thrift stores. I've done that for years and years and years. Because I knew, like, I always say, if I had kids, what I would do is take one toy every year that they like the most that year, buy it new, package it up, and put it in a box. Don't let them know it, but just keep their favorite toy newly packed in a box. They will thank you for it because, you know, they're all running out and buying that shit, you know, for thousands of dollars later. And I see it. Yeah. Like, every day I see these things getting bought and I'm like, oh my God, you know, somebody just spent $3,000 on, like, you know, the first Game Boy or whatever. Like, it's crazy out there. And that's not.
Yeah. It's a mixture of, that thing I could never have when I was a kid that now I'm an adult and I can have, and, or the one thing I had that was like my happiest thing. And I just like, it's fetishized, you know?
Yeah. You know, I've noticed, because I do know a lot of people do that thing where they buy something they couldn't have then. That's definitely a big part of that. And then the other thing, though, I've noticed, there's a real connection, because I definitely was poor and I didn't.
Same.
But, you know, the other day, I won in an auction. This is the dumbest thing you will ever hear me say. But I won in an auction. I paid way too much for it, but I needed to have them. These pens where some train is going up and down and cows are...
Oh, yeah, the floating one, yeah.
There's one in the pack that has a naked woman, not my favorite.
Yep. Her clothes slide off when you... Yeah.
But I was, like, I remember having one of these as a kid, and I was obsessed with that thing because all my friends always wanted to put it up and down, up and down, and I think it had a little train from Switzerland in it. And I swear to God, when that package arrived, which I paid way too much for, but when that package arrived and I had that pen in my hand, the adrenaline that caused, it was like taking a drug. And that's why we do it. That's because it's not necessarily that things were easier then, but you weren't an adult. And so you didn't even recognize all the adult problems. And I think especially in difficult times, that's why, man, when that pandemic started, the fucking vintage stuff that was bought was insane. Oh,
yeah. Insane prices. Like comics that I had forever that were worth nothing. People all of a sudden paying like thousands for. I was like, this is crazy.
And the cards, you know how I was a card collector, but I...
Me, they're so boring.
I started people going crazy, and I knew I had some in the garage somewhere. I had to pull them out, so I thought maybe I'm like missing the big lottery ticket here. Of course, I ended up only having like nothing of value because, you know, I take from thrifter, but... boy, it was just, and I think that when grown-ups suddenly in the pandemic started to like buy these cards left and right, and like, you know, cards that were like Pokemon cards, but Pokemon 90s cards and stuff like that. And I started thinking like, this is escapism because I know what it is. I do it myself, you know, and it's
that's
dumbest things. Puffy stickers is another thing for me.
Oh yeah, it's the thing where in John Hughes, I think it's in it's either in Pretty or Pink or Breakfast Club, but there's a line that's very overly dramatic and emo-y. That's John Hughes, but it's, he has one of Molly Ringwald's characters say like, when you grow up, your heart dies, which sort of encapsulates all of the things that he puts in those movies. And I think it's the same thing when you're younger and you're a kid, you feel things so much more intensely and things you experience for the first time, and it imprints and it sets your expectations for how things will feel forever. So it's almost like you're chasing that your whole rest of your life, but because it's almost like a physical thing. Like it's the first time you've held this thing, you got this thrill that is still wired in there.
And even though all the feelings are intense, which I absolutely was the highest emotion intense kid for sure, you know, you still, we're not an adult. So like my I remember my parents always had trouble paying the rent. We're always behind stuff. There was definitely money concern constantly and stuff, but it still wasn't up to me to pay the rent, right? And I also didn't know how the world worked. I didn't know who starts wars about what. You know, there's just a time when you become the adult and when you suddenly have to pay your own bills and, you know, you're starting to look at the future, you're starting to look at climate change. The pandemic certainly brought a lot of things home. And it's dire, and you're the people in charge. And what I think, to me, what it does, you know, is going back to a time where I knew people had problems, but it was adult problems. I didn't have problems. You know, and that that time when it's really the kind of saying ignorance is bliss. And that's as a kid, you are kind of ignorant about, no matter how smart you are and how you know, I definitely got a lot. Like I knew my dad was from Palestine and that other people thought he was a terrorist. You know, I knew all of that.
Right.
So it's not that I was completely ignorant of it, but again, it was like, oh, you know, there are these adult problems and, you know, I'm just have to worry about my crush and my school and why I don't have the same bag as every other kid, you know, those kind of things. And they were just more innocent. And I think there's a real longing to go back in that time. But that's why I think, like, I don't get executives in TV who look at this. It was all over the press how vintage has popped during the pandemic. I don't see how you look at that and not tap into that. It just blows my mind.
It's, I mean, they're always behind. It's bizarre. Two things that reminds me of, and I won't keep you all night because I would talk to you forever.
Oh, no, I apologize. I can talk to you forever.
Is one, I'm very curious to hear what you thought of the movie Atomic Blonde.
Elizabeth edited that. So, you know, that's why I have to praise it, because her editing is fucking amazing. I mean,
it's amazing, but it's set in Germany. It's nostalgia. It's kind of everything we talked about.
It is. And there were parts of it that I was like, I thought it was great. And it was,
I loved it.
It was great action. And honestly, Elizabeth, if you look at her resume, I wish people would talk about her more. And I'm not sure if they, like, you know, it's funny. We underestimate editors, but I think she made a lot of these movies, you know. She cut the first John Wick, you know. Like, editors make these kind of movies and when they create, and she's definitely that person. And to become that person, like, she's like the, like, she's a woman from Iceland where they have 300,000 people, okay? For her to become the number one go-to person that everybody, I tried to call her, like, you know, for this. And, you know, she's booked for until 2050. I think every
action. She's the go-to action editor.
Yeah. And she, you know, that as a woman from Iceland, like, the Iceland is even more impressive than a woman here, because, you know, really, it's 300,000 people, like, and you have to really go out and go somewhere else to become this, because there's nobody looking for that there other than Bjorn, maybe. So, you know, it's so impressive. And she's really that good. Like, she's exceptionally good, because she had to beat a lot of guys and girls and Americans and, you know, like, she had to beat a lot of people. So, yeah, I love that. There were parts of it that I looked at. I was like, okay. You know, it's like when guys direct women fighting, there's always a little bit of, you know, stuff.
Sexual male gaze. Especially. Like cat, maybe it'll turn into a cat fight.
Yeah, especially because, you know, obviously I was a fighter myself. And, you know, one thing I know for sure is you don't ever look sexy when you're fighting. Like, it's impossible.
No, fighting is ugly.
Your hair is down. You're not going to have a good fight. So you have your hair in a ponytail, and then, you know, you go off. And most of the time, I look at old videos of mine, you know, where I'm fighting, and people always ask. And I'm always like, fucking hell, I look like shit in the, like, my hair's like,
you look like you've been in a fight.
And so I'm always a little bit like, you don't have to make to look somebody ugly, but you know, women sweat, the makeup doesn't stay on, you know, you can't have your hair down and actually see anything. Like, there's just a lot of stuff that I, you know, and also then there's a gravity issue, which I always have an issue with, you know, because I know what it feels like to kick a guy who's twice your weight. You know, that guy's
yeah.
to move.
Yeah.
You know, so there's that. But, you know, look, I love that, you know, they were not afraid to hire her. Clearly did a great choice because she then made John Wick great. And I forgot, was on Atomic Bomb, was that by both of them or by one of them?
Both of them.
Yeah.
I think on this one. Yeah.
They're a good action directing team. They come from stunts. You know, my that's basically my career.
They know how to shoot that stuff and edit that stuff. That's it's like a magic trick. You have to know how to show it.
So I have a lot of respect for them. And I, yeah, I like that movie. You know, another one that was, I think I saw, and that, you know, a big show for me was, now I have to think about what it was called here, Fall Guy.
Oh, yeah.
It was called in Germany, Ein Colt für alle Fälle.
Alle Fälle is the funniest Fälle, term. I don't know.
Fälle is cases. And so it was called A Colt, which it was his first name, A Colt for all cases.
Okay.
Yeah. But, you know, I don't know why they didn't call him Fall Guy. I guess that would be hard to translate. But I was obsessed with that show. I didn't realize until years later how sexist it was.
Oh, yeah.
But then at some point when I started noticing, and I think I'm sure you saw me tweet about this as well, you know, when I started noticing that remakes are now being made, right, I immediately told my agents, like, please see who has the rights to Fall Guy. I'm dying to do a show called Fall Girl. And I had this whole idea of, you know, this amazing, like, you know, black stunt woman who's kicked, who's just this kick-ass stunt woman who also, you know, maybe not, the bounty hunter is a little dodgy for me, that whole,
yeah.
you know, but I wanted her to be like, you know, who moonlights as, you know, maybe the opposite of a bounty hunter, like the people who, you know, who set the people up or keep them jailed, something a little bit more social.
Yeah, it's almost like the new version of The Equalizer.
Exactly.
But with the Fall Guy.
Yeah, as you know, yeah. I have to watch that because that's getting such good reviews. So
it's a good take. I really like the original Equalizer, especially when Robert Mitchum took over, just because I'm a huge Robert Mitchum fan. But this take is interesting, especially in light of the fact that people forget that the Denzel Washington movies were pretty recent, and this is completely unlike them at all. It's much more like the A-Team than the Equalizer, but Queen Latifah is great in it. Yeah, it's I pitched a show a few years back that with a comedian friend of mine, because I would run into this scenario where a bunch of my friends are stand-ups and they would get a lot of heat, and so people would want shows from them, but they're like, I only do stand-up. So they'd be like, I'll write something with you. So I'd basically write the thing. But one of my friends, we pitched this show, and it was about a stuntman who for some reason was indestructible. He didn't know why, but he also had to like hide that fact, but he was like a very in demand stuntman. And you know, it was a comedy kind of thing, but I was kind of framing it like the Fall Guy, and everyone was like, what's the Fall Guy? And I'm like, there was a massive show. It wasn't that long ago.
I have to say, I haven't met anybody like that. Even the younger people kind of know, well, I don't know. Most people I pitched to, I guess, were kind of at least Gen Xers. So who knows? It might be maybe the younger ones or not. But that was definitely a big show here and a big show there, you know?
Again, action show. That's what translates. It's so easy because
yeah.
comedy is so local, but action kind of translates regardless of language in a lot of ways.
Yeah, I wonder if we had any dramas. You're right. I can't remember. They're all, they were pretty much, we had the A-Team was big, you know? I remember just as I left, like how big 90210 was. So that was a drama coming in. Like that was, oh my
right.
God, that was huge. You know, another really huge, massive, massive show was the Bill Cosby show in Germany. And I thought that was really interesting. Yeah.
That is interesting.
You know, I always like hear people say, and I don't know why they keep saying that, it's just such bullshit, that that, oh, you know, black actors don't translate in Europe, da, blah, 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 because there's no black people. All this shit. People said this for years, especially about movies and stuff. The Bill Cosby Show was one of the biggest shows in Germany, for sure. If you look up the ratings, that was like a number one show. Eddie Murphy couldn't walk through Germany without getting mobbed, you know. So I, you know, we definitely got a lot of, and here's the interesting thing, which I always try to explain my friends here, you know, a lot of times in the U.S., black shows were basically black shows. Yeah, they had a black audience, yeah. Right? Mm-hmm. But that wasn't the case in Germany. Like, in Germany, it was an American show. Not that they're not racist, okay, but it's mostly an ignorance. Like, there's a certain infatuation with America, right? Everything from America. That's why Michael Jackson was huge, Eddie Murphy. Like, you basically have to teach them to be, like, you know, once they find out that, oh, we don't like that guy because, you know, then the Germans catch on to really quick. They jump on the racist train like there's no tomorrow. But when you just give them the show and represent it as an American show or this is an American singer, you know, they don't make that decision right away.
Well, it's almost because they don't have a lot of black people there and we do have them here. That's why it seems American. Exactly. It's like, yes, America has a lot of blacks. So that's what America is. Were those dubbed or were they subtitled? Out of curiosity?
They were dubbed. Yeah, that's the bad part. And they were all dubbed with German actors, which is still going on today. And I fight them over this all the time because there is actually a lot of black Germans now. There's a huge community of black Germans and they could hire all black people. And, you know, I don't think they really realize that there is actually a difference in, you know, maybe not in Germany as much as here. I still think that you have to use a black voice actor to dub a black actor. So the other countries, like the Scandinavian countries, don't do the dubbing thing. So it's weird.
Yeah, I always wonder with comedy, especially where or shows that are built around a specific personality, like Bill Cosby Show or an Eddie Murphy movie, where so much of the sort of charm and the thing that people like about it is the person's the way they say things and that kind of thing. You know, so I'm like,
they did a good job with like Beverly Hills Cop, for example, because now I look at it and I'm like, how the heck did they make that funny? With a German, yeah. Dubbing him in German. Because it's so basically, you have to know the difference between Beverly Hills and where was he from? Detroit, right?
Detroit, yeah.
Yeah, and so, and he had a different way of speaking, but they made it happen. They made it happen. They, you know, now I look back and I go, ugh, I wouldn't watch that again. But they sure made it work for that time. Yeah, so it's interesting. There was a lot. Like, I mean, in the 80s, there was so much TV-wise and movie-wise that we just, you know, just ate up from the United States, you know?
That always fascinates me, like what gets there. And then you, speaking of shows that were huge in Germany that were actually huge everywhere, we were talking about Baywatch the other day, which was, people forget, was literally the number one show in the entire world
for like a decade. And it's actually really interesting because somebody, you know, there was one time an article about it, how big it was, and that they were somewhere like, you know, I think somewhere in India in like the huts and they were running it and they were all running to the one, like in countries where I'm like, how do they even relate to a Venice Beach and fancy like that, right? It was, you know, Middle Eastern countries, African countries, Asian countries, European countries. It was big everywhere. It just tapped into something. And I think that had a lot to do with, I think they were like Barbie dolls, you know, I think to the
rest. Yeah.
I don't know what it was, but boy, there was whole tours. And Germans would always take these damn tours where you go on Venice Beach and they say, this is where there is the thing and the thing. And then always, I remember that when I first moved here, every time I had somebody from Europe come, they wanted to go to Venice Beach to see that they run into him. And sure enough, one time we actually ran into them. Like there was David Hasselhoff in a, and I just thought that was the craziest thing because now I thought they will never give up in asking me to take them there, but they were still shooting that. It was in the 90s, I think.
Yeah, it went until almost 2000, I think, and they were still shooting it. It's funny because the story about that show where, and you may or may not know this, it was on NBC for one season and it got canceled. It was a huge bomb. And so the producers in Hasselhoff had this idea, which was completely crazy, where they said, hey, you canceled the show. Can we buy it back? And then we'll make it in syndication because you're not doing anything with it. And the studio's like, yeah, take it here. Pay us for it. We're not doing anything. And then built that worldwide audience with doing it on their own in syndication, which is insane and made the studios feel so stupid and so angry that they had missed at this thing.
I wonder how that – I got to look more into that because how did they even know, like, who to sell it to? I guess they must have. But then how did the studios not know that there is – That
a demand for it.
Countries wanting, that's wild.
I think a lot of times the network, especially at that time, worldwide rights, they didn't really care. And so a lot of things, they would either have episodes edited into a movie and then they would actually sell them to theaters in Europe and in Japan. So you had shows like The Master with Lee Van Cleef. That came out as like three martial arts movies in Europe. It was a, you know, 2-season show or The Night Stalker. They released those, they'd smash episodes together and release them as movies. And it was just kind of seen as like extra money. They would never try to really make a show to make new episodes for. So I think they didn't even think of it.
Yeah.
And I mean, they missed out on billions of dollars.
That was smart of them, I have to say.
Because you were offered, they tried to get you to work on a remake, right?
Yeah, that I think was one of the most amusing stories I've ever experienced. Because my agent, her name is Cindy, she's been around for a long time. I think her brother actually worked on The Fall Guy, she just told me a while ago. But she's been around for a long time and, you know, she's like very business-like woman and she calls me up and with my manager on the phone, and they both have this really curious voice. And she starts off with saying, "So, a funny thing happened," and I'm like, "Oh no!" Now I'm already thinking somebody complained about me. But she goes, "I got a call from Fremantle? I can't even remember anymore. It was one production company that does stuff all the time, right? And said they were asking if you were interested in remaking Baywatch." And she said, "Before you say anything, let me just tell you that immediately as he asked me, I went into a tirade of, you don't know who you're talking about." She said this. And apparently she went into this whole like, "Oh my God, Lexi is a feminist." And she's like, that's the last thing she would do. And the guy, the executive, called and interrupted and said, no, Cindy, listen to me for a second. That is exactly why we're reaching out." And then I literally went on the phone, "Oh," and my manager went, "Right?" Interesting from there. And she said, "Yes, so let me tell you what happened." And now this is like, it just takes these two sentences. And now I'm like, everybody's curious, right? So she says that the executive explained that the original creator never wanted to have a show the way Baywatch was. That's not what he sold and pitched. What he pitched was a show about people that were very in tune with their environment and kind of concerned environmentalists. My head just like exploded, you know, because that it ended up being Pamela, what's her name, and David Hasselhoff.
Anderson.
Bikinis, yeah. It's not the surprise. That's actually the least surprising, okay? But when I heard that, I thought, yeah, my God, what a great idea, right? And I just also had read something, which I'm going to tell you at the end of this, but that just made it fit. I'm like, that totally makes sense, that's what he wanted. And I guess after years of like having watched this and the success, I thought maybe I get another shot at this. Maybe I can do it again, but do it right, especially now that we're talking about being a little less toxic and less sexist. And I thought, yeah, great. And I remember, I think I was shooting something somewhere. I was shooting maybe a TV show in New York. And I was like, set me up a day after I'm back, which I never do. I always tell them, give me a week before I come back from show, then set up the meeting. I said, the day after, I said, I'm dying to like get into this. And in the entire time when I was directing that show, I got so excited about this. And I had the perfect idea in my head. Like, this whole thing about them being environmentalists, this is actually for the rest of the world, not necessarily in the US, but in the rest of the world, this is very true. There's lifeguards doing amazing things that have to do with the climate change, the environmental impact and everything. And I read about that all the time. And these are not the kind of lifeguards we would recognize just from Baywatch, right? They have a totally different kind of profession and responsibility, but they're super interesting people. And I had just read that article about this Syrian girl who basically escaped on a boat and swam, survived because she was a good swimmer, landed in Germany and became a lifeguard. I think she's an Olympian and a lifeguard. So there was, and there's multiple, there's not just one, there's multiple of these Syrian and Afghan refugees who've become lifeguards. And one of them was about how they're fighting this, you know, island disappearing because of climate change. I was like, that's what I'm going to pitch. And I came in and I didn't even let them get the word out. I'm like, I have the perfect idea for doing this. And I started talking and they were actually really enthusiastic. They ghosted me afterwards. I never heard from them again. Not. We didn't even hear like, oh, we decided not to go with her pitch. Like we just got ghosted. Nothing.
I wonder if just any of the financing got pulled or something.
You know what I said to my agent, because I've been asking her, because I said, I'm so sorry, I can't get them on the phone, nothing. And that's not usually what people do. I mean, look, people pass on stuff I pitch all the time. And I interview for directing jobs and they have no problem calling me and saying, yeah, we're not going with her. It's actually sometimes worse than that. Okay. You don't not call my agent and tell her like because you're afraid of, you know, hurting my feelings or anything. So that was really strange. But I have this odd feeling that somebody made up that they had the rights. They didn't.
That's it could be.
I think you would be embarrassed to admit, you know, right? Because, you know, anything else is just, we hear this stuff all the time. But ghosting, and because also it seemed like such a bizarre, like such a like, why does nobody know this? And what a great idea. And my God, why aren't you meeting the most famous person in this town? Because this is such a great idea. I actually thought I had won the lottery, that they would specifically want me for this. But it did always feel like too good to be true. Like if you have this idea and you really have the rights for this, you probably go to somebody more famous than me, you know?
It's possible. I mean, there was three people, really, some brothers, I think, and another guy in Hasselhoff that owned the rights. I bet there were people thought they have things when they don't.
That's what I think.
Or pieces.
Yeah, that's what I think.
And then
Or I think that I'm even go so far, because this is really what I could imagine. You don't want to tell anybody that they just randomly met somebody who pretended who had the rights, but never had the rights.
That happens a lot.
Yeah, you know, that's what I think, because I just couldn't believe that nobody knew about this, that there wasn't a line outside. And usually when studios, you know, when people call, you know, somebody they think is a feminist in the business, there's so many other people that I don't necessarily think are intersectional feminists. But, you know, for those kind of offices, I'm not the go-to feminist. You know, like there's Gina Davis is, you know, but not, you know, you just, and again, I'm not saying this to diminish me, but I just really know how this town works. They can't really tell, you know, who is a real feminist. Who is they don't even know what intersectional feminism is. You know, you call the one that is like the kind of like poster girl that they think, like Gina Davis is that person. And that's who I would have gone to, like if I were there. To call me is so out of the ordinary too. And the guy actually said, oh, that was one of the creator suggestions. So I'm thinking like, oh my God, this creator is a fan. He's followed me on Twitter. Like I'm thinking all these things. I'm thinking this is like the real deal. Because I do sometimes have like the oddest things where somebody asked for a meeting who's like really like on the board of Universal or something like this. And I can't figure out why, like, why would somebody that powerful want to see me? And it's like their kid follows me on Twitter.
Yeah. You never know. Like you put stuff out in the world. You never know. Like I've gotten things like that where I'm like, oh, that person followed me. They're like, yeah, I know you from, I'm like, really? That's weird.
Yeah. You know, I mean, and it's the darndest thing. And sometimes it'll actually work in your favor, you know, I think it works a lot, not in your favor. I just don't hear about it. And frankly, I don't want to, but sometimes it really does. Like somebody said, well, if you want somebody who's a real feminist and also you know, intersectional, like you call her. And that this guy from the board, I was like, I've never even met a board guy. Like, by the way, I can tell, like, behind the scenes, he's pulled a lot of strings, because I get a lot of, like, pushback sometimes because I'm so outspoken on things. And so sometimes these powerful people, so it wasn't completely far-fetched, but when they ghosted me, I knew that this was just not a thing, like, because I also saw nobody else doing this.
Right.
But the thing why I like talking about it on Twitter and why I don't mind talking about it is because the idea in itself is a really great idea. And I'm wondering what else we're not looking at and saying, you know what? We did a dumb, stupid thing with this thing. But, and by the way, I mean, how dumb and stupid can you call it when the whole world watched it, you know? But
yeah,
it was a thing. It's a brand name that everybody recognized. Can we actually make something good with it? And I think, you know, you really could with some brands, you know?
Yeah. I mean, the two things come to mind. One is one of my favorite quotes from David Cronenberg is when he did The Fly, they were asking him, like, you know, is this your favorite movie? Is that why you're remaking it? Is this, you think this is the greatest movie ever? And he went, no, the original Fly is a terrible movie. He goes, but it's a great idea.
Yeah.
And he goes, you remake a great idea that was poorly executed.
Yeah.
You don't remake a great movie because you don't need to. And so that, I think, is exactly this. But the idea that it was an environmental show isn't that far-fetched to me, because I've become friends with Alexandra Paul, who was the female lead on Baywatch. And Alexandra is a militant environmentalist and animal rights person, like, gets arrested, you know, handcuffing herself to places in order as environmental person. And she really, that was one of the reasons she took that gig. She was also an Olympic swimmer and a bunch of other stuff. But so that actually makes sense. I'm actually curious. I'm going to email her to confirm some of that.
You should. And I'm dying to know who is this creator, or did they really talk to somebody else, or did it not? Because I've never asked my agent, did they do it with somebody else and stuff? But I don't think that ever
happened. I've never seen it.
And this is... If somebody would do it other than me, I would totally applaud this, because it's a good idea. I just personally was so excited because I had just read about all this. I mean, can you imagine, like, these Syrian, you know, refugees who became these, like, top swimmers who are just want to be – a lot of it has to do – I don't remember the details now, but the article I read had a lot to do with the Greek island that they land and what they had to do there. And it basically awakened that that's something I could do with my life. They're so good at it, right? And so it's a little bit of, like, circumstances that make you become an expert in environmentalist. And I've always also had this idea that, you know, there's so much to be told about indigenous people everywhere, but Native Americans, you know, basically having to do a lot of the repairing of the damage that sea have done. And there's a whole show there that I think people are ignoring, right? I'm actually very surprised, to be honest, because years ago I thought, oh, you know, watch this, the environmental thriller is coming. And that, I have to say, after the Day After Tomorrow and stuff, it never really, like, caught on, which is odd to me.
It's I have a whole theory on that. Oh, if you have a moment, yes. I can tell you. If you look at the 1970s, when dystopian sci-fi was, like, at its peak, and it was all those environmental, you know, Soylent Green, even Planet of the Apes, you had smaller movies. Like, there was a great movie called Zero Population Growth that was, like, this dystopian future and everyone can only have one kid, like, all that kind of stuff, grim things, but all based on the idea that, hey, the environment's gonna collapse and, you know, we're gonna have to do something about it, up until, like, the Mad Max stuff. Then that was always somewhat underground, even though, like, the Road Warrior and became very popular. Sometime in the early 2000s, and I attribute this to video games, but I may be discounting it, that sort of dystopian stuff, that post-apocalyptic stuff, became wish fulfillment. So all the zombie movies, all that post-apocalyptic stuff became people going, oh, it'd be awesome, man. Like, I could be the king. Like, society would collapse, but I could have, like, guns and I could, like, take what I want. And, like, it became this weird, instead of that's horrible. We've been reduced to this, you know, pre-industrial revolution living because we fucked up and we collapsed the world. It became this weird wish fulfillment. And
you mean like those preppers?
Yeah, like preppers or even like The Walking Dead. It becomes like a new society where I can reinvent myself as the king of this. And, you know, you get to go be a badass and, like, you know, shoot zombies. And, you know, it's like it becomes this Wild West wish fulfillment thing instead of horrific. And I feel like environmental collapse or environmental horrors don't jive with that, because you can't have wish fulfillment in these post-apocalyptic things if you're like, oh yeah, everything's underwater and there's no food, you know, or you're like, population's too much, people are fighting over bread. Like, and I saw movies, the movie that made me realize this was, there was a great movie called The Trigger Effect from 97 with Kyle MacLachlan and Elizabeth Shue. And, it's the premise of the movie is, on a Friday before a long weekend, the power goes out. No one knows why, never gets explained. And over the course of 3 days, you see society completely collapse, completely collapse in the ugliest way. And it's so well built where, like, their baby has an ear infection. They need to go get antibiotics. The pharmacy can't give it to them. Their brother-in-law brings a gun because he's like, this kid needs the thing. Stuff escalates. Like, it just, shit goes wrong and it's ugly and it makes you feel bad in a really well done way. People hated that movie. And I'm like, because it's not wish fulfillment. It's telling you how bad that would be.
Wow. Wow. That's really interesting.
Because it's environmental stuff is too real. It's you can't pretend it's cool. Like, you can't be like, oh well, everything would flood, but I'd have like a badass speedboat. You know, like, it's not it's not like sexy. It's, you can't pretend you're the action hero in those worlds. Kind of
the exception then.
Yes, but that was,
it wasn't Independence Day. The Day After Tomorrow.
Day After Tomorrow, and that didn't. That didn't do that. They pumped a ton of money into that. Right. But even that, people were kind of like, oh, I don't want to be told that we're bad. You know, like, it becomes this, like, people don't want to be reminded that they're fucking everything up.
That's
and that there's really consequences.
That's, now I'll be thinking about this all night now and going through everything. Because, you know, you kind of think about, like, how, like, every year we have the Oscars, and, you know, like, my whole pet peeve is that you're always using the Middle East to win Oscars. You go there to do war.
Yeah.
And then you guys, all of you Americans, go and get Oscars about how horrible it is and how, like, how much, like,
you make a movie about how much you did bad things.
Yeah, and how much you now suffer from post-traumatic stress syndrome. Like, I mean, I'm always like, are you guys not seeing it? Like, it's horrible, you know? And then, but then there was also Vietnam, and there was, my God, and so many, we're still talking. And some of these movies were super well done. Like, I still have screenshots of certain movies where I'm like The Deer Hunt and stuff, where I'm like, that is the greatest fucking cinematography and stuff.
Vietnam was different.
Yeah.
Vietnam was, especially since I've been doing the show and reading, like, the way it was presented then, Vietnam was the first war we had in America that was presented unfiltered. So previous to that, we only got government reels of, like, World War II, fight Nazis. But literally every night on the news during dinner, people would turn it on and they would see dead bodies. They would see people on fire. They would see the horrors that were happening day to day. And that was a first. That was absolutely a first. And the way that permeated the pop culture of the 70s was part of that dystopian stuff. But I'm, as a big horror fan, I always look at horror movies as the perfect allegory of what's going on at the times, even if it's not intentional. It just, that's what seeps in. And things like Romero's Night of the Living Dead, which was also kind of about the race, rights for race, racial equality, new societies and stuff. But you start to see it seep in with Vietnam, where people are like, this fucked us up, but because we were wrong. Like a movie like Jacob's Ladder, which is amazing. I don't know if you've ever seen that. That's such, that blew my mind. And there's a movie called Death Dream from 1975, and it was made by Bob Clark, who did A Christmas Story of all things. And it's basically The Monkey's Paw. These old people, this couple's kid dies in Vietnam, but they refuse to believe he died. And then he shows up at their door one day, and he ends up being this zombie that's like eating people to survive, but they won't let him die. And there's a scene in this movie where the guy has dug his own grave and he's trying to bury himself, and he's basically begging his parents to just like let him die, because he's a monster now. And it's this amazing allegory for like war fucking people up. But people got sick of that. They were like, we don't want to. And part of it was Reagan, because after Jimmy Carter, who was
Reagan,
like,
hey, had a lot to do with it, because that changed. Because, you know, see, that's what I gotta look more into that, which is such a good, interesting thing, because it really kind of shows it. Because Vietnam, you had a lot of movies about Vietnam, a lot. And by the way, not all, and wasn't also MASH, you know, there was.
MASH was set in the Korean War, but was about Vietnam.
Right. But MASH, didn't it come out just like right after the Vietnam War or something like that? Not too long?
Yeah. It was contemporary with it, because Vietnam War went on for 10 years.
Yeah, so the mood was kind of like anti-war, and here's this show, and it's a sitcom, and always, as somebody not from here, it was so weird, you know? But they were also all anti-war, and then you had all the Good Morning Vietnam and the Apocalypse Now, like all these films, like there's that genre was all over the place, right? Born on the 4th of July, like it was just... It never ended. Like, there was so much. And I thought, God, you know, those Americans, man, they really don't mind kind of showing their, you know, bad side, which I only, when I got older, I realized, oh, no, that's them basically also winning awards and showing how much they suffered for that.
Yeah, it's sort of, I think part of it's revisionist history, but not as much as later stuff. One big thing, like one practical thing that changed was, in order to make those movies, they needed the participation of the U.S. military to like get equipment and advisors and all this stuff. And the U.S. military was kind of not very savvy about participating in something that made them look bad. They didn't quite get it. And then they got savvy.
Yeah.
So by the time the 90s rolled around, they would be like, well, no, we're not going to help you with that unless you do it this way.
Now it's the opposite, though. And that was only a small time in the 90s, because now they have a whole department and they tell you what to put in your movie. I mean, I know.
Which is why they're all, yeah.
That remake of Red Dawn, like they were told to change the national, you know that story, right?
From the Chinese, yeah.
And that happens left and right. And there's whole movies, my God, where they have put money in and stuff. I mean, we have really government sponsored, like, you know, movies now.
It's propaganda.
But, you know, in a sense, like, I'm thinking, like, I really am, now I'm really obsessed with this, because I wonder how you could break that about environmental movies. Is there any way? I do get, and I feel like that now. I think the more traumatized you are, like I didn't want to watch a movie about the pandemic during the pandemic. I think the more traumatized you are, you don't want to turn on the TV and watch more drama. And I've really, you know, noticed that my mind can honestly not take it.
It's not cathartic as it was in the past. Like, you could see that thing and you'd feel better about it, but it's not that now.
And I don't want to see any dark things where people are constantly dying. Like, I just want to see, like, you know, stories where there's hope at the end and stuff. I didn't used to be like that, but now, and then it's
because, me either.
No, especially, like, I remember during Trump times, almost everybody felt like that. And then the pandemic came right after, and nobody wanted to, like, I kept thinking, why are people making movies about this pandemic? That's just crazy. So, you know, that I get, but the environment is still kind of, people still don't think it's right in front of our house, right? And for them, I think for most people, climate change is still obscure, to be honest, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, I really wonder if it's about, oh, you're making us all feel bad, because that's interesting. I never actually got through that movie, what was that movie, Look Up or Don't Look Up?
Oh, Don't Look Up. Yeah, that, I think the execution was a little off, but I think they had the right idea, because I think the way that you can get these things through is allegory. It's the Twilight Zone method. It's you tell a story that's about the environment. But if someone doesn't get that, they still enjoy the story, and that piece kind of seeps in, but they didn't know it. Like you had to code it. You know, it's the Trojan horse thing. You have to tell them a story that on the surface, or if someone isn't as aware, is not about what you're telling them it's about, but you're teaching them the same lesson.
That was really obvious about it, that they were basically, you know, I guess it was not necessarily an environmental thing that we have caused, but I also, to be honest, couldn't get through it. There was just something that bugged me about that movie. That
the tone I didn't like. It was too, it was a little snarky, like it was, yeah. It seemed insincere or something. It's tough to do. I mean, I think that's why we haven't had like another show like even Black Mirror, which is the closest thing we have to a Twilight Zone type show.
Me too. You know,
it's too dark.
But it's too dark for me. Like I find that really interesting.
Well, I would bother you for hours and hours. So, you know, maybe we'll do a part two at some time. But I'm so glad we got to do this. Thank you for doing this.
Invite me for part two, part three. I'm a big fan. Now I'm an even bigger fan.
There you go. That's Lexi. As I said, she's great. She's just the best human being. She's basically a superhero. I am happy to call her friend, and it was very nice to get to chat with her at length. So if you weren't familiar with her before, I hope you are now, and that you will check out everything she works on, and let's get that Baywatch thing made. All right, everybody. If you would like to get in contact with me, and for whatever reason, if you want to request guests, or we can just talk about Baywatch, whatever you want, you can be a patron of the show at patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. As little as $1 a month is a huge help to me doing this show. I haven't missed a week yet since February 2014 when the show started. I hope to keep it that way. If you want to request guests or just anything, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com or through the Patreon, or I am on social media at Kenneth W. Reed and at TV Guidance. Love hearing from you guys, and be sure you're here next week for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
I would not fucking do a flying back fist. That's the opposite. A flying back fist is an asshole move.